Good afternoon. We start this afternoon with portfolio questions on rural economy and connectivity. Question number one from Christina McKelvie.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the rollout of broadband in the Hamilton, Larkhall and Stonehouse constituency.
Cabinet Secretary Fergus Ewing.
The £400 million investment from the Scottish Government and our partners are making through the Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Programme will extend fibre broadband access to at least 95% of premises by the end of 2017. Without that investment, only 66% of premises would have been reached. To date, the programme has provided fibre broadband access to 4,215 premises in the Hamilton, Larkhall and Stonehouse constituency, 95% of which are capable of accessing superfast speeds.
Christina McKelvie.
Can I welcome that, and I'm sure the 4,215 premises in my constituency will welcome that too. However, constituents from the village of Stonehouse in my constituency have had a very difficult time with getting access to broadband, and when they do, they've experienced loss of service, a slow service, which has been disruptive not only to domestic use of broadband services, but to the many businesses in that area who depend on an uninterrupted high-speed service in order to do their business. Can the Cabinet Secretary look into the particular problems faced by my constituents in Stonehouse and reassure them that everything possible is being done to provide them with that quality service from that £400 million investment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm happy to provide Ms McKelvie with that assurance and I'm happy to receive more details from her if she so wishes. She will appreciate, of course, as we all do, that telecoms and telephony is a reserved responsibility for the UK Government. But despite that, we are committed to providing 100% superfast broadband access by 2021. I'm obviously aware that BT are handling many of these cases. I'm very happy to take up any particular case with Ms McKelvie, who is obviously working hard for her constituents on this serious matter.
Question number two, Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met the board of NFU Scotland and what issues were discussed.
Cabinet Secretary.
I last met the board of the NFUS on the 22nd of December last year when we discussed cap greening and the issue of linked holdings in relation to livestock movements. And I can also advise I'll be meeting with the new National Farmers Union Scotland presidential team tomorrow morning.
Douglas Ross.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response, and my question allows me to wish the new NFU Scotland board announced at their recent AGM all the best, and in particular to Martin Burse from Pitgavenny Farms near Elgin, who's the new regional board member for Highland. The NFUS was very supportive of the new farm advisory service when it was launched in September last year. This scheme costs £20 million and will run until 2020. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us what the uptake of that scheme has been so far and what has been the feedback from crofters and farmers for this new service?
Cabinet Secretary.
Just this morning, I can assure members that I was discussing with the Rural Committee some of the good work that is done by the SRUC, and that includes, for example, arranging, facilitating, and handling meetings for farmers to understand the opportunities to avail themselves of greening measures, which, as well as good for the planet, are good for their pocket. So there's a wide range of activities that are being undertaken by SRUC. I did actually have discussions with SRUC on various matters recently and have asked for a further meeting specifically to address the issues that Mr. Ross fairly raises. After that meeting, if he wishes, I'm happy to go over with him what they do, because it is a substantial contract and it's absolutely essential, Presiding Officer, that in these challenging times where farmers risk the possibility of facing the loss of their CAP and SRDP financial support as a result of the total failure of the UK government to give any details at their end, we must do all that we can to address these matters.
Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary what changes it's taken forward to the greening measures in response to the NUFS and farmers' concerns.
Cabinet Secretary.
Three particular measures: shortening the period during which maintenance of field drains is prohibited on ecological focus areas, that's EFA fallow, from the 1st to the 15th of July to allow hedges to count separately as EFA and agroforestry supported under the forestry grant scheme and located on temporary grassland will be able to count as EFA. I and Ms Cunningham, the Environment Secretary, also announced the establishment of a group chaired by Professor Russell Griggs that has been asked to undertake a forward-looking review of our approach to greening. And further, we plan to publish our analysis of the impacts of changes to rules as requested by stakeholders. Further research will be commissioned on these matters. It's my understanding that these twin announcements of specific measures and also an ongoing approach of serious consideration of these matters has been broadly welcomed by farmers and their representatives.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sure the NFU's board will wish to discuss with the Cabinet Secretary the progress being made in terms of payments for 2017, but at a recent meeting with the NFU's locally in Orkney, a concern was raised around some uncertainty about the payments for 2016. Some farmers are still yet to receive payments, and given the change in the regime, I think there is a lack of clarity there. Would he consider writing out to all farmers, explaining the payments that have been made and any outstanding amounts that may still be due?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Ms MacArthur raises a perfectly reasonable point, and I can assure him and all other members that these matters occupy a great deal of my time and attention, and rightly so, and that my officials are working flat out in order to address these matters. I believe that substantial progress is being made, I can also say that I discussed these matters in Shetland, not in Orkney, but in Shetland on Monday with the farmers there. I think I should perhaps point out, as Mr MacArthur will know well, that in respect of the various farming payments, that a loan scheme was brought in and was implemented in the first fortnight of November, and that made sure that for most farmers they received up to 80% of their full entitlement, and they received that earlier than would normally be the case. And that did inject, Presiding Officer, I think a sum from memory, not unadjacent to £278 million to the rural community in Scotland, including in the Isle of Orkney, where farming is of such importance.
Question number three, Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met representatives from the Scottish Roads the Scottish Roads Partnership.
Minister Hamza Youssef.
Keith Brown, the Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Jobs and Fair Work, last met with representatives of the Scottish Road Partnership, the project contractor, on the 1st of February 2017, when he visited the site to view the progress on the Raith underpass. Transport Scotland, of course, part of the Scottish Government, officials meet with representatives from the Scottish Road Partnership on a regular basis.
Margaret Mitchell.
I thank the Minister for that answer and very much welcome the significant progress made on the ongoing works at the Raith interchange, including the opening of the East Kilbride underpass. However, there are problems with a lack of appropriate signage generally, and in particular to make motorists aware early enough of the new EK underpass road configuration, where many drivers are ending up on the bypass by mistake. They then have to do a detour and double back to get to the Bothwell Glasgow turnoffs, which adds to the confusion and congestion at the Raith. So can I ask if the Minister will take up this issue, and can he confirm the completion date for the entire project?
Minister.
Thank the Member for the constructive way in which he approaches the issue. Major roadworks, of course, will involve disruption. We do our best to advertise that disruption and diversion routes as early as we possibly can. But I will take her point in regards to signage. I'll ask the contractors and indeed my own officials in Transport Scotland to look again to see if anything can be done. In terms of the completion date, I will stick to what's been said about spring 17. That is the schedule that we're working towards and when we expect the entire project to be complete.
Neil Findlay.
Can the Minister advise why the Government chose the Scottish Roads Partnership PPP model as opposed to a traditional roads maintenance contract? And will he agree to publish the level of profits being delivered through this public sector contract to the private investors involved?
Minister.
You know, if Neil Findlay was sitting here in this role, which I think is a feat of imagination, but nonetheless, if he was, I don't think they would have constructed the amount of infrastructure that we've managed to do, the M8, M73, M74 project, AWPR, of course, the drilling of the A9, the A96, and many, many other infrastructure projects. I'll write to the member to give him a little bit more information, but he'll understand, of course, commercial confidentiality is important. But this government has a great record of not only delivering infrastructure projects, but delivering them on time and on budget, and that's something I'm very, very proud of.
Neil Findlay.
I simply ask the Minister if he will publish the level of profits that being provided under this contract. Will he do that? It's a public contract.
Minister.
Well, I said there's commercial confidentiality, and I'll explore what can be published and what can't be published, what's appropriate, what's not appropriate, and I'll write to the member in that regard.
Question number four, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what it's doing to tackle livestock worrying.
Cabinet Secretary Ferguson.
We are fully supporting the campaign launched recently by Police Scotland to highlight the importance of dog owners keeping their pets under control when walking in rural areas. This campaign is being run in conjunction with the Scottish Partnership Against Rural Crime, SNH, and the representative body Land and Estates, and is timed to coincide with lambing season, Presiding Officer, when the effects of livestock worrying can be devastating. Police Scotland are committed to use the law robustly if dog owners fail to keep their dogs under control, including investigating all incidents of livestock worrying and reporting cases to the Procurator Fiscal with a view to securing convictions.
Liz Smith.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response and also for the very helpful information that he's just provided. He will know about the really dreadful event that happened in Muthal when a whole field of sheep was destroyed, pedigree sheep was destroyed in Muthal. And according to the NFU Mutual, the cost of dog attacks and livestock is estimated to be about 1.4 million right across the UK, and that the costs have more than trebled in Scotland. I appreciate what the Cabinet's just said about the policing of this issue, but could he also tell us what is happening to ensure that the farmers who are affected are actually reporting the issue in the first instance?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, my attention has been drawn to that particular episode. It's absolutely devastating, not only for the financial, but I think the emotional consequences for any farmer seeing his livestock suffer in this way. It really is appalling. And I think it must be said the primary responsibility must lie with the dog owner to keep his or her dog under proper control. Indeed, there is legislation, Presiding Officer, which criminalises a dog owner that attacks livestock, chase livestock, or be at large, but not under close control in a field. So there is legislation in place, but of course that legislation requires on evidence for there to be prosecutions. And that's why in 2015, the former Solicitor General conducted a review to ensure that this matter was taken absolutely seriously, which it is. And to respond to the second part of a question, I would obviously encourage every single person who sees, witnesses an incident to report that to the police. I think that is really our civic duty, and one which, if taken seriously by most people, as I'm sure most people do, and of course most dog owners are responsible dog owners, then that duty to report would in itself be of great help in part of the solution to this serious matter.
Question number five, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports Scottish firms in the food and drink sector in accessing public sector contracts.
Cabinet Secretary.
Significant progress has been made in recent years, with almost half of our public sector food and drink contracts now awarded to Scottish businesses. But I want to see more of our schools, hospitals and public sector organisations taking advantage, Presiding Officer, of the high quality food and drink produced in Scotland. And that's why I convened a roundtable discussion earlier this month to bring together the supply chain for the first time to discuss the barriers and opportunities to increasing local sourcing in public sector contracts and help boost the economic potential of food and drink sector. And a range of actions are now being considered, and a further roundtable event will be convened later this year to review progress.
Gillian Martin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In my constituency, there's great concern amongst food producers like Macduff Shellfish and Mintlaw that they will face severe difficulties if they cannot get a guarantee that workers from other EU member states can continue to work in Scotland when we leave the EU. What contingencies should we be suggesting to them as they prepare for the future, for example, as they bid for the kind of contracts that we've just discussed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member has raised an extremely important point, and I know from my own visits in Peterhead and Fraserburgh, and indeed this week to Shetland, just how absolutely crucial the continued presence of EU nationals working in the processing sector and the food and drink sector is to Scotland. There's around 8,000 working in that sector, and a further 15,000 EU nationals are employed by Scotland's farmers. They are all welcome in Scotland, and we want them to continue to be welcome. If they are not, as a result of the granite-hard Brexit plans proposed by the UK government, then we may see the horrendous human tragedy of people leaving because they are not welcome here. That is repulsive and repellent to us. And it also would have the effect of shrinking the economy. Because if a processing factory relies on half its workforce being of EU origin, living in Scotland, and that factory cannot continue to operate, the other half, Indigenous Scottish residents, will also risk losing their job. This matter could not be more serious for the rural economy, and therefore this Scottish Government believes it's essential that everybody stands up and defends the right of EU nationals to continue to work here and enjoy this as their home, which of course it is.
Peter Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm glad that the Scottish Government is treating the issue of local food procurement with the importance it deserves. There is, however, a real performance gap between our better achieving rural areas and underperforming urban areas in regard to public sector contracts. What further work will the Minister undertake to narrow this gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, just in the last couple of weeks, I've convened the very first event of its sort in Scotland of bringing together those involved in procurement, and I'm not sure that I would necessarily accept the presentation of event of the situation as put forward by Mr. Chapman, although if he wants to send me evidence, I will happily have a look at it. But I think that there has been great progress made in sourcing more food and drink from Scotland and from local sources. But the issues are very substantially practical and business ones. The supply of food and drink is very much a business issue. Farmers and cooperatives, for example, need to be able to cooperate to provide food and drink to large retailers on a day basis, 365 days a year. There are business issues here, and government shouldn't dictate to business. However, there is a great deal of goodwill amongst local authorities, the Scottish Government, and all businesses involved in the chain, and I think working collaboratively is by far the best way to advance these matters.
Question number six, Alison Harris.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the incidence of avian flu and what advice and support it is giving to commercial and domestic poultry keepers.
Cabinet Secretary.
To date, there has only been one confirmed finding of a highly pathogenic avian influenza, H5N8, in Scotland this winter, and that was a wild peregrine falcon found in the Dumfries area. There have been no confirmed cases in domestic poultry or captive birds in Scotland. Presiding Officer, I've met with key representatives of the poultry and game bird sector in the last few weeks to discuss how we can best support keepers during this unprecedented situation. In addition, we have regularly provided advice and support to poultry keepers on how best to protect their birds at this time, done so through digital media, news releases and emails to a wide range of stakeholder groups. We also arranged for the Animal and Plant Health Agency, AFA, to issue email and text alerts to subscribers through their notifiable diseases alerts service.
Alison Harris.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response? Subject to no further outbreaks, when does the government expect to be able to lift the current restrictions on the movement of live poultry?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think I would answer the question this way, that I'm not a scientist here. We act on advice from Sheila Vost, the Chief Veterinary Officer, obviously, and her colleagues. However, my understanding is that this virus is one which is not expected to be, if you like, killed off until the warmer weather arrives. And therefore, it's not reasonable to expect that there will be an absence of problems until perhaps May or June. There has been a number of outbreaks, confirmed cases in England, 9 cases, and we have on veterinary advice taken the step of indicating that when the current prevention zone comes to an end, or at the end of this month, it will be renewed, but it will be amended so that birds may be let out subject to heightened biosecurity. That will have the benefit, of course, that those who are producing free-range eggs will not be liable to forfeit their free-range status, provided they maintain the other conditions apart from, obviously, being outdoors and free-range. This is extremely important to Scotland because there is an enormous amount of money involved here, £46 million of business, so this is not a minor issue. That is why I met many of the players involved, including some farmers who are very important players in this field, and it has been receiving the utmost attention, which, of course, is quite right.
Thank you. It was a detailed answer, but there's a couple of supplementaries. I'm afraid we don't have time. So that concludes that section of topical questions. We move on to environment, climate change and land reform. Start with question number one from Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure the safe restoration of open cast coal mine sites in East Ayrshire and the south of Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Rosanna Cunningham.
Following the liquidation of Scotland's two largest coal mining companies, a cross-party Scottish open cast coal task force was established to deal with the key issues of coal sector employment, improving regulation and promoting restoration of legacy sites. Two subgroups to the main task force were established in 2014 to look at and make recommendations on compliance monitoring and financial factors. And the final report to the task force was published in October 2015 and included a comprehensive suite of 29 recommendations. In addition, a short-life coal restoration working group was also established to take forward and progress the recommendations of the task force. It met between February and October 2016. And the Scottish Mine Restoration Trust was formed in May 2013 to seek innovative solutions to restoration. That is currently chaired by Professor Russell Griggs and is continuing its work and has now taken over the ownership and care of 8 legacy surface mines. So the Scottish Government continues to work closely with councils, communities and with industry to ensure the safe restoration of surface mines in Scotland.
Brian Riddle.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. As you will be aware, the mining companies were supposed to be accumulating a restoration fund to ensure the landscape could be properly restored after mining was finished, though regular surveying and cost analysis. The eye was taken off the ball, and when the Scottish Gold folded, it was unfortunately discovered that the funds had been grossly underestimated. These sites scar the landscape and at the very least need to be made safe for the local communities. There are, however, some very innovative and interesting alternatives to just making them safe, such as pumped hydro storage schemes or bike tracks or outdoor activities, which could attract visitors to the area. Would the Scottish Government commit to at least the very minimum investment required to make these sites safe? And would the Minister further consider looking at some of the very interesting projects that may be worth further investment?
Well, we are already supporting work with funding, and that is the work of the SMRT, the group that has been working since 2013 on this. I think most of us would agree with the concerns being expressed by the member as to the environmental on-cost of the effective closure of these mines and the consequences thereof. I know that a very great deal of work is currently being done and continues to be done, and I would have hoped that my initial answer would have indicated to the member that this is an issue that this government takes extraordinarily seriously.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Related to similar, what is the Scottish Government doing to address the coal-related damage to the Muirkirk and North Lowther Upland Special Protection Area?
Cabinet Secretary.
As the member may be aware, on 10th March 2016, we published details of the package of measures now being deployed to address the ecological impacts of open cast coal mining in the Muirkirk and North Lowther Upland Special Protection Area. Work is ongoing and includes the partial restoration of the Pow Harnell open cast site, the restoration of the Greave Hill open cast site, the re-establishment of supportive mitigatory land management and the extension of the SPA to compensate for the permanent loss of habitat. In addition, work to remove an overland coal conveyor from the SPA was completed last year. We've made significant financial commitment to support the completion of this work, with some £2 million spent during the current financial year and a commitment for a further £8 million over the next 4 years.
Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether she or any of the organisations involved has considered making clearer definitions of restoration at a Scotland-wide level? For instance, it's been raised with the East Ayrshire Council, the possibilities of three definitions: restoration, partial restoration or reinstatement, and alternative use. And a number of constituents have approached me to highlight that this would help in letting community groups and all those involved know what the process was that was happening on particular sites.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Member is raising an interesting point, and it may very well be that it is part of the discussions that are already taking place, but perhaps not in as overtly defined a way as she might wish. I'll make sure that her comments are drawn to the attention, particularly of the Trust itself, to see whether or not there is a way to make that more systematic, which I expect is really what the Member is looking for.
Question number two, Peter Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has in place to prevent the spread of diseases which affect woodland and forestry.
Cabinet Secretary.
Tackling threats to tree health is a priority for the Scottish Government, and our approach to preventing the spread of diseases that affect woodlands and forestry is set out in the Scottish Plant Health Strategy published in March last year, and I hope the Member has had an opportunity to have a look at that. The aims of the strategy are to demonstrate the importance of safeguarding Scottish plant health to protect and enhance Scotland's economy and natural environment, to indicate how Scotland will take forward the plant biosecurity strategy for Great Britain, and to ensure that the Scottish Government and stakeholders work together to protect plant health in Scotland.
Peter Chapman.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the Minister for that answer. A few months ago, Forest Enterprise Scotland confirmed that almost 20 hectares of woodland will have to be felled as a result of the spread of larch disease into new areas in Argyll and Stirlingshire. Surely with a spread into areas outside the so-called management zone, it means efforts will have to be increased across the whole of Scotland to stop the spread, and the Scottish Government must act now, as the strategy for 2015-17 is surely not effective enough.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I outlined the position of the Scottish Government in respect of the general issue of plant health and indeed tree health. In preparation for this question, I now know more about potential diseases in trees than I thought I would ever need to know. And I am conscious of the concerns about the spread. There is still, if I recall correctly, a view that the West Coast remains the biggest concerning area in respect of this issue, and it is one that we are keeping under close observation. But the Member will also be aware, I think, that effectively being concerned about the health of our forests is a matter for everybody involved in it, not just, for example, the Government or the Forestry Commission. It is also a landowner responsibility and the responsibility of all of those involved. I do not believe that the Scottish Government's plans in respect of how this is taken forward are in any way insufficient. The draft budget has protected Forestry Commission Scotland expenditure, and we do anticipate that this budget will be adequate to meet our ongoing tree health requirements at similar levels to recent years.
Angus MacDonald.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. At times, the only option when woodland and forestry areas are affected by disease will be to clear the area, so I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will agree with me that replanting of trees is crucial. Can she give details on the number of trees that have been planted in Scotland since 2007 and how this compares to other UK nations?
National statistics estimate that since 2007, Scotland has planted 59.4 thousand hectares, or around 119 million trees in new woodland creation. The estimate for the same period in England is around 50 million trees for new woodland and 9 million for Wales. The replanting of trees following felling will be in addition to these numbers, however, and detailed estimates of replanting numbers are not available. The figures that we have are initial planting rather than replanting.
Question number three, Liam MacArthur.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what consideration it has given to piloting the devolved management of seabed assets to the island communities of Orkney and Shetland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Ministers, first priority is to complete the devolution of management of the Crown Estate to the Scottish Parliament and ensure a smooth transition, and that takes effect on 1st April this year. We have made a commitment that communities will benefit directly from devolution of the Crown Estate. After Crown Estate revenues are devolved to Scotland, coastal and land communities will receive 100% of net revenues raised from Crown Estate marine assets out to 12 nautical miles. With the three island councils, we've been exploring the potential for piloting enhanced local accountability ahead of legislation on a new long-term framework for managing Crown Estate assets in Scotland.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and also thank Rosanna Cunningham for sparing the time to meet with Tavish Scott and myself recently on this very issue. From that meeting, she'll understand the long-standing desire within Orkney and Shetland to take responsibility for managing the Crown Estate assets, extending what is already happening under the Orkney and Shetland Acts. And it's not just about the revenue, she knows, it's the opportunity to manage the seabed resources that are so critically important to the island communities I represent. Will she therefore agree to allow Orkney and Shetland to lead the way and take forward pilots ahead of legislation being introduced to Parliament later on this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member may be interested to know that I'm meeting with the leaders of the three islands councils on 2nd March, and discussions will continue between the Scottish Government and the island councils on the potential for a pilot in the islands. We have received an outline proposal from them, which is being considered, but I think, as I indicated in the meeting which the member referred to earlier, that a detailed proposal is required to enable us to make a proper decision. And I know that both himself and his colleague Tavish Scott will ensure that they are kept well informed on the progress of this, and I look forward to further meetings, no doubt, with both of them, singly or together.
David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my view that the Smith Commission stressed the importance of devolving seabed assets to local authority areas such as Orkney, Shetland and Western Isles? And is the Cabinet Secretary sympathetic and indeed relaxed about further empowerment of island communities and avoiding centralisation in Edinburgh?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the member knows, there is an ongoing consultation in respect of the long-term future for the Crown Estate Commission. We've had to devolve initially in the way that we've done it on an interim basis to bring the devolution to Scotland, and the consultation and future legislation will determine what the long-term plans will be. As the member is aware, there's a variety of views about that, and it is our intention to ensure that as many communities as possible benefit directly from this, both in terms of, indeed, as the previous member pointed out, the funding, but also the management.
Question number four, George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures that the environmental standards in towns and cities help promote Scotland's image.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises the importance of the environment and its contribution to the quality of life of our communities, as well as Scotland's international image and reputation. The Scottish Government supports delivery of local environmental standards through its establishment of policy frameworks, supporting tools and funding to local authorities and other organisations.
George Adam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Does she agree with me that in these challenging economic times, it's even more important that our towns and cities' environment is clean to a high standard? The Cabinet Secretary may be aware that the previous SNP-led Renfrewshire Council won awards with their Clean Renfrewshire campaign. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that educational campaigns like this are a way forward in ensuring that we keep our towns and cities clean and promote a positive image of Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, our national litter strategy supports higher quality local environments, and I do encourage all local authorities to share best practice so that successful approaches to influencing behaviour can be replicated or adapted to suit individual council circumstances. Not every plan will fit every area, but where there is good practice, such as the Clean Renfrewshire campaign, other councils would be advised to have a look and see if there are lessons that can be learned.
Question number five, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to reduce the incidence of fly tipping.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to tackling fly tipping. We have provided SEPA and local authorities with the powers to fine people who are caught fly tipping, the minimum fixed penalty of £200 to a maximum fine of £40,000 if prosecuted. Zero Waste Scotland has introduced the Fly Mapper system to enable the recording, managing and reporting of fly tipping, making it easier to catch offenders and to deal with illegal dumping sites.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Keep Scotland Beautiful's 2016 report, Scotland's local environmental quality in decline, painted a concerning picture of increases in littering and fly tipping. Keep Scotland Beautiful is calling for a review of the effectiveness of these fixed penalties, which the Cabinet Secretary's outlined, to see whether or not the enforcement is actually deterring this. Is the Scottish Government planning to take this forward and commit to a review of the current penalties?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we keep these issues under review on a constant basis. We're wanting to ensure the maximum environmental standards for Scotland, by doing the work that we do behind the scenes, ensuring that that is something that is kept going forward on a regular basis. The member will be aware, however, that with respect to fly tipping, it is difficult to catch offenders. And as much as I would like to make an argument for increasing penalties, which I rather suspect lies behind his question, the issue is more how does one actually get individuals to court in the first place? And I think that that's an important aspect of the assessment that needs to be done. Increasing penalties is one thing. Actually getting people into court is what will be key. And I hope that he would agree with me that perhaps that is where we need to be putting our focus in the early stage. There is no reason for anyone to fly tip material when councils are providing both recycling and residual collections. And I think every one of us here would condemn that it happens.
Christina McKelvie.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it is the responsibility of councils like South Lanarkshire to ensure that those known to be guilty of fly tipping are held to account whenever possible and do all they can to encourage responsible disposal of items of rubbish?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will have heard some of the comments I made to Miles Briggs. The real trick here is to know who is responsible. And while we may colloquially know in some places, knowing in a way that allows us to take that evidence to court is different. But I do think that councils do play a vital role in holding fly-tipping offenders to account. We have supported them by increasing the level of fixed penalty they and others with enforcement powers can impose on fly-tippers when they identify them, and we encourage the use of these powers. There is also guidance. I perhaps should have mentioned this in response to Miles Briggs. There is also guidance to enforcement officers who deal with the illegal disposal of waste in Scotland. It's within a document called Fly Tipping in Scotland, a guide to prevention and enforcement. And it's perhaps something for those who are interested in this particular area to go and have a look at.
Question number six, Ivan McKee.
To ask the Scottish Government what the value of Scotland's natural environment is to the Scottish economy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland's natural environment is estimated to be worth around £20 billion per annum to the economy. That's £20 billion, not million. Many of Scotland's growth sectors, such as tourism, energy and food and drink, depend on our high-quality air, land and water. And we believe that protecting and enhancing our stock of natural capital is fundamental to a healthy and resilient economy, which is why in 2011 we became the very first country in the world to establish a natural capital asset index.
Ivan McKee.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Does the Cabinet Secretary therefore agree with me that it's essential that we continue to invest in our environment and work to unlock opportunities which will not only help protect the environment but further benefit Scotland's economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, yes, I would agree with that. Investing in our natural environment is important in helping to grow the economy. We make that point in the Scottish Economic Strategy, which does explicitly state that protecting and enhancing our stock of natural capital is fundamental to a healthy and resilient economy. And I would draw members' attention to the fact that much of our wonderful produce is sold on an image of Scotland's environment, which I would hope always was reinforced by a reality. And it is really important that private sector particularly understands that that reality has got to sustain the image they choose to sell their premium products on the back of.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland's prosperity is intertwined with Scotland's natural capital. That's why the Scottish Conservatives have made natural capital a key part of our new environmental policy paper launched today. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain what specific steps the SNP government are taking to develop a holistic model to leverage finance to protect our natural capital?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I've already indicated, this country is the very first one in the world to establish a natural capital asset index. I would have expected the member to have welcomed that fact. I am aware of the document that was published today, and can I reassure the member that I will be looking at it all very carefully indeed. But one of the standout highlights so far is the Conservatives in Scotland committing to two new nuclear power plants for Scotland, with no indication whatsoever of where any of the money for that is coming from. Indeed, that was something absent from the entire document, not a single cost put to anything. And I do wonder, when the member wants to arise in this chamber, whether or not he might have regard to that aspect of things as well.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. The next item of business will be a ministerial statement. We'll just take a few moments for ministers and other members to change seats.